Good evening, Free Enterprise fans. Welcome, welcome. We have another great Moonvale mixer match for you between Klopfer and Slippery. I'm Commander Leonhart, and I'm joined here on comms by Wreckit. Wreckit, I see a very fast hero over there on Klopfer's screen.
That is indeed a very fast hero. That's going to make some exciting moments here starting off.
Yeah, an edge start with agility like that is going to slow down every boss fight you come up against, except for the really, really fast ones. And a lot of the early ones are so slow that there are some fights that I wouldn't be surprised to not get a turn in at all before they're done.
It always makes it exciting for the racer, for those early ones, you know, just breeze through them, not taking a single hit. And then you get to the later fights where, oh, this is actually causing problems.
It can be a little tricky to deal with if you're not used to the situation, but there are a lot of ways it can work in your favor too, if you know what's there and how to handle it. As far as our extra objectives, we've got returning the pan, taking out the vanilla ribbon room, and turning in a pigtail.
Bunch of interesting objectives. You always like seeing the ribbon room because it's usually a good check when you're running low on the key item checks. You get two chances there. I feel like we've been getting pigtail a lot in this tournament, though. I feel like it's every other restream has a pigtail turn in.
Yeah, I mean, there are only so many tough objectives to work with, so there's bound to be a certain repetition. I've got someone I chat with regularly who swears that it's Complete the Giant of Babel that always shows up. But yeah, it's definitely a thing that with only so many to work with, you're going to see something show up eventually. But at least with tough quests, it guarantees a little more work to be done and more action, as opposed to, say, having the random quests come up. Complete the boss of Miscave, rescue the hostage at Hobbs, and complete Mount Ordeals.
That is true. And it looks like we're getting started. Who's going to... Hey, it's Double Edward.
1-2, Prince is here before you. You have the spoon flag on, so if that spoon flag turns up, then word can go from a few Nishtrats to being a competent damage dealer in his own right. And even without that, if we run across some decent bows and arrows, he can still contribute. We might have max tier 5 on, but that still allows for samurai bow and samurai arrow out of non-trap chests.
That's very true. Yeah, I feel like Edward's very underappreciated. Like, we love it when there's a spoon word swing in for thousands of damage, but he's actually really decent, even with just a bow.
So we've got an Odin and Baron N1 along with Rosa. Rosa's a great character to add to any party. For a white mage, she's very, very durable, and it's good to have that in your healer.
Yeah, you will never see anybody complain about a white mage that doesn't fall over at a gentle breeze.
Klopfer, in the meanwhile, is looting. The rune ring is a little insulting. We started out with 10 of those already in one of our starter kits. Come on now. But if you were just coming here for some money to do a little more shopping, you at least accomplished that. And Klopfer's immediately running down to Victoria, so that could well be the case.
What, you mean you don't want 11 rune rings? It's like 2 for each finger.
It'd be a bit much. Although if you could equip them all on one person, that would be some impressive spellcasting.
Any mage enemies wouldn't have a chance of doing any damage.
No, they would not. And that's a good point. The rune rings does protect against damage from mages, and there are a lot of mage bosses and even a few mage trap chests like the Mad Ogres where that becomes important.
I have lost track of how many times a rune ring has saved me from the particularly rude Mega Sisters.
Yeah, especially since your typical rune ring wearer is in the back row anyway, at least for the parties I set up. You get the benefit of that too, the reduced accuracy when coming after someone in the back row.
Yeah, you know, you occasionally have that, that full mage team where, you know, somebody's got to get regulated to the front row, and that makes it a little less scary.
Good point. A little bit of variance in initial looting, as happens. Got a fair amount of choices. We might be on max tier 5, but we are on Wildish, so not all locations are the same, and there's the coffee to consider. Oh, casual sork robe in the grass in Mist Village, that's a nice find.
And black belts in the shop, that's a pretty nice mist right there.
Yeah, black belts are good now, and the sork robe will probably be good later, so the time clock for spending there definitely paying off. Slippery, however, is going to be the first one to go after non-looting progress in the seed, setting up to check the Hobbs hostage. I like starting out here. Even with Edge, I'd still like to get more people on. Though there's an argument to be made that all of these other people are just slowing Edge down and getting in the way of him taking more turns.
Yeah,
oh, but it's Vanilla.
You're fine. It's a fun little balancing act, because, you know, you always think, oh yeah, you know, I gotta get more characters, because the sooner you get them, the sooner they can start getting experience. But at the same time, like you said, it's just people clogging up the turns that Edge could be taking to just plow through this overworld.
Bring on the puns, Aaron Lore. No fear. And that looted Ice Claw doing some work, and that fight is over quick. Yeah, I tend to agree with you on this flag set. Hobbs tends to be my first check, and then I go straight over to Baron Inn for the next one, unless I'm stuck with a really weak party and I just don't have faith in them taking out the two spot. But this party, I'd not be worried at all.
Yeah, it's generally my play too. I either Antlion or Baron Inn too, and looks like we got Slippery going Antlion.
Yep. It works. It's on the way. Oh, and, you know, a Thunderclaw out of that chest definitely works.
You'd never hate to see it.
No. We talked a little bit earlier about all of the mage enemies, and there are also a surprising amount of bosses that are weak to thunder, so slapping that elemental on Edge's attacks is a very good thing. Oh, come on! Enough with the rune rings already.
Nope, it's a rune ring seed. Any percent.
Apparently. Rate that looting. 2 out of something rune rings.
That's a rune ring out of 10.
Right. 99 rune rings go by. You know, at this rate, Aaron Lore, you might be right. Grab 99 rune rings, take them to Cory for super secret sciencey stuff. What sparkle be ye? Ye be our D-Lunars.
That is a good place to find them, at least. Well, good for the runners, not so much for us. I'd rather see them somewhere a little more exciting.
Yeah, if they found it more exciting, we get to see the fun things like reflected frog strats, perhaps. But here, firebomb or big bomb, and you're done.
Maybe just a white spear for your troubles. Not something you want to see early on. Definitely hope for a key item, but hey, we find a cane. That's a pretty poking stick right there.
And it looks like Klopfer decided the Hobbs fight wasn't worth his time, I kind of get it. Again, we touched on this earlier. More characters are just getting in the way of Edge taking superior actions, and also Edge is going to be very busy using those claws. We'll need to have a hefty amount of claws lying around for Yang to reach his full potential.
There's something you always have to see with Edge Hero. There's a boomerang for sale in Fabul.
Yeah, we like that because it lets us back Rogue Lich Edge, though you have to make sure to equip the boomerang briefly in his right hand. He's a bit odd in his coding that way.
It is. You would think him being omnidextrous, it would not matter, but you know, guess again.
Right. That Silver Knife Ice Claw still doing work for Rubikanta. Just goes to show you the benefit of pairing elemental weakness to main weapon damage. And yeah, Oda goes down, but not before taking Edward out. Dark Imps, meanwhile, are invading the Fabul, and we've got Kainazo in the 2 spot. Quick math says we're fine.
Yeah, it shouldn't be too bad, but again, we're getting all the rude bosses out of the way early. It's, you know, where's the thrill? Where's the drama? Where's the suspense?
I hear you. There's still some potential for rudeness at that ribbon room. But Kainazo was extremely rude there. The wave that you're seeing is based on his current hit points, and there are a lot of hit points at the ribbon room boss. Down goes the Kainazo. Meanwhile, Slippery picks up a tower key from the Fool defense and Klopfer with an earth crystal. I think this is still early enough to loot the treasury. It's the max 5 makes it a little unimpressive, but I think we're early enough. What do you think?
Yeah, I think, Natty, we're just 10 minutes in. Yeah, I would not be surprised if we go grab that. You know, maybe pick up a nice ninja sword. I think the T5 would be the max. Is long swords or ninjas for Edge?
Ninja you can find in tier 5, which is nice. It's got decent attack power, but it also gives plus 5 strength, so you're putting forks in that for multiplier there.
Yeah, and that's a little piece of steel for the overworld. Get you through quite a big chunk of the underworld too, probably.
Yeah, and actually, double ninja's legit for an endgame Edge. If you want to berserk him up and have him swing into the Aromas with that, he'll still be able to put out meaningful damage.
Very true.
Upper running to work deals without a Tella or Assassin.
And that's interesting. I don't hate it, but
same.
I don't know. It could pay out.
It could. There are 3 bosses here, and we've got Fabul Gauntlet and Golbez as boss objectives, along with D-Mist setting up a key item check back in the Village Mist. So there's definitely something to be said for it, and there's also the knowledge that your opponent might leave it behind. So if you find something here, it feels good. And there's that pause!
There you go. Just speaking into existence.
Now, normally for a lot of early gauntlets, you're happy to have Edge around, but any of these fights that have these spirits or souls, you're still going to have to chip them out or break out a J item. Maybe that was a trade that was looted.
Yeah, unfortunately, those spirits are absorbing the ninja flame attack, which does clear everything else out. There you go. You see the mob like that is just upsetting.
Yeah, you're just gonna have to deal with it. little bit of moment to move something important up to the front while driving the Zeus Rage. Little bits of optimization there can sometimes make a big difference. Zeus Rage as Slippery works on his own Baronin. Yeah, we're gonna flame this one. Just a bunch of skeleton types.
Quick and easy, just the way we like it.
So obviously now, the question as we're going to be watching Slippery go through this race is how committed he is to the ordeal's fate. Without finding a Cecil or perhaps a Tella, the longer you stay away from it, the harder it is to get back to it.
That's true. It is a long check. You do have three bosses, and with this alt gauntlet that Slippery doesn't know about, but we do, it just does increase the amount of time it takes for just one key item. And like you said, without a Cecil or Tella, you don't really have a lot of incentive to go up there right away.
Yeah, back attack Bahamut. Should be fine. Edge should slow him down enough. Reserving that white sphere in case Kane is located. Just sticking with the one dart. Oh, trying for the power staff rock. I like it. It's a nifty heads up play, but it's gonna be difficult to pull off on an edge hero.
Yeah, especially I don't believe that Rosa is backwards, so she will suffer some edge or accuracy loss.
Right. And even if she does hit it, there's the weird quirk about procs that they depend on how much of an ATB gauge your target has charged up. And even as the anchor, the fact that he's edge, it's going to be tricky. But we have a treasury to rate.
Rate that treasury!
It's not a bad treasury. I saw a ninja sword, a leviathan.
I saw an Aegis shield. Another gear that provides that lovely mage resistance. Oh, we have a hook! We have a hook at Ordeals to go along with that football quality. Do you know what that means?
Nothing good for our runners, I would imagine.
It means that Ordeals is hard required. We've got to do 6 out of 7 objectives, which means if there's a location that gives you 2 objectives, either directly or indirectly, then at some point, if you want to beat the siege, you're going to have to go there.
Yep, Valgrim pointing out in chat, Ordeals is a big deal.
Yes, it is.
call out to our team name. Thank you.
Now, if the hook is the logical path underground, Slippery will have to be there eventually. But if there's a magma key somewhere else, like in this very Tower of Zod, the vanilla magma key, then it could be a long time before Slippery gets back to that reuse.
Yeah, definitely have to hope this pays out somehow for Slippery, either with the key item or just kind of nudging in the direction of Ordeals.
Yeah, that nudging in the direction of Ordeals would be, from with what we know, the best possible result. Slippery might not be too thrilled with the Cecil, might feel like, oh great, now I gotta do Ordeals, but it's the best thing he could do. You know, we talked about Cella. Cella. Is that going to be the new anagram for Cecil and Tella? I don't think that's going to catch on. We talked about Cecil and Tella. But, Paul Grants is pointing out a hope for the Foo, and given the way Foo powers up, Ordeals wouldn't be a bad, Chase.
No, that is true. He does gain HP and spells for every boss you defeat. But them, I would say, depending on the... Oh. Sorry to just cut myself off mid-thought, but I just saw Slippery found an admin, assuming from the Flame Dog chest. Yep. That's big.
Yep. Jalapeno Puppy handing over the really good stuff.
That was, as I was saying before I so rudely interrupted myself, depending on the spells that Foo does come with, might not see much of a need to go fight bosses to get more. If he's got something that'll take care of it, like if he comes pre-packed with Quake, I could see Slippery putting off ordeals more.
Sorry. Wow, Profness. Just wow. I can't even. There's Leviathan in the Eblin shop. Not too impressive given that we have one in the treasury. But the Bacchus is nice.
With an edge hero, you definitely would love to see the Bacchus be sold somewhere. And Drain Spears for sale too, if you just want to start getting a little throw happy.
And a Full Moon, which is a legit upgrade over the weapons he's using. Slippery is through his first fight in Zot, taking a precautionary save, which is very wise when you come here early. There are a few bosses that can take advantage of the ruthless magic power in this spot to give you a really, really bad day.
There are way too many puns going on in chat.
I'm here for it.
I am too, but it is. It is something here today. That did take me a second. Bacchus, I'd rather Mozartus. That took me a second.
I see all of these puns in chat. Amadeus. That seems like a reasonable plan. Having Iridia in Cave Eblin with a Leviathan in the Eblin shop and also in the treasury. Simple, yet. You just give her that Sorcerer Robe, rather. And go for one of the Charm Rods, and by the time she gets up to 50 MP, Leviathan should be doing work.
Absolutely. I don't believe Flopper has done the treasuries. Doesn't know about that free Leviathan. Hopefully doesn't spend the money, and that is a Golbez. Oh boy.
Yeah, so objective good news. Bad news... we've got a coin flip. Golbez is going to leave two of these people alive, and one of them will get to hop into the queue, and if that person ends up taking the initial spell, that's going to be rough. Now, Edge apparently is wearing something to protect against the paralysis, so that'll help. Oh, the adamant armor.
Yep.
The
yeah.
Dirt. Or else would you put the item armor? So yeah, he'll avail up and we'll be fine. But yeah, the adamant armor, you know, we're gonna take the whole time of why to extol on the virtues of adamant armor. It's got some incredible physical and magical defense stats on its own. It protects against every status ailment known to this game. It also grants you immunity to all elemental damage. And if that wasn't enough, it also adds 15 to all of your stats.
Yeah, it is a nice piece of equipment to pick up anytime. You know, seeing as we do have the pink tail for an objective, that's another admin to get. So that would be two for Slippery, and well, Flopper doesn't go hunting for the chest, which wouldn't blame him, since the K-trap is not on for the Moonveil users. It does kind of discourages, we'll go with that one, that's easier to say, doing those checks.
So, we don't hate it. We don't mind plus 10 to strength for whoever is busy swinging things. Even more multipliers. Gosh. Plus 5 strength from an Ninja Sword, plus 5 strength from a bandana, plus 15 from an adamant armor, and plus 10 from Zeus. Ooh. That's...
Since we get an extra
swing for every 8 strength, that's 4 extra swings.
Yes, how hard would you like your edge to attack? Yes.
Right? the katanas will be fast and furious. Slippery is indeed making his way over to Ordeals, so that'll be a second objective, and but for also crisscrossing, heading up Zot to be a second objective as well.
Yeah, we have gotten a few nice key items, but not really opening much of the overworld up at least, so makes sense that this is where everyone would end up, kind of flip-flopping between.
Yeah, as you and Fire Blizzard are pointing out, unless you want to hunt down a very rogue Demas, you've got to come here, so that magma key wasn't there to keep it away. But it was bound to happen.
Yeah, that's true, and I don't think I think Slippery did check the waterfall boss, but I did not see what it was.
You're right in that Slippery did check it, but I also don't remember what it was.
Pretty sure it was a reset, so it's not our Demas or anything. Oops, gotta point out it was Mom Bomb, so definitely reset out of that.
Hey, that's another boss you really don't want to see in the Ribbon Room. Spot has enough hit points as it is.
Seriously, how many extra does Mom Bomb add to whatever spot she's in?
9,000, which is when you're in that window, is when the puff up and explode happens. Unless you can cut through it in time.
And depending on how quickly we start making moon checks, might not really be able to get through that before the bomb goes to me.
And Clopper's gonna miss out on that adamant armor. I would have missed out on it too in this race. I'm willing to look at the first two chests for the jalapeno puppy, but I am not going to chase into the pitchfork, as Fire Blizzard is referring to it as.
Yep, I also would be missing out on this. I'm very much the same way. First two, if you don't show up, that's alright. I'm sure it won't be anything important.
Yeah, we certainly won't have a fight coming up shortly where the adamant armor would play a pivotal role. Nah.
What are the chances? Distant ominous laughing intensifies.
Right. So Heart, Forge, and Pinktail, and of course Darkness Crystal. These are all of our key items that are progression. Anything else is just only if it's a chain.
Pretty much. Just throw it in the pile, get us close to that 10 key items, just in case we need to grind up later.
Yeah, doubling XP doesn't hurt. We've seen the Evelyn shop doesn't give us our Siren's answer, but any other gated shop is a possibility, so the Tomra shop, the Feymart shop, Dwarf Castle Shop and the Shop on the Moon are still possibilities for holding sirens for the generally preferred grind.
I guess the big question is, you know, we're wrapping up the overlay that we've had. Where do we go from here? Slippery, with ordeals done, has run out of options. Has already done the Abul and Antlion check, hasn't gotten anything. To check the Mist Cave, see if maybe a little bit of vanilla got in here, but other than that, the only thing is to really start diving that hook route.
Yeah, and we got a little bit of... I remember the ruby sprite in Zot, and that tells me that Elements is a dwarf too, because we've already seen actual ruby. But I don't remember who was taunting Rydia in Cave Emblem.
Say it was a lunish partner. That sounds right.
Okay. Well, then, we know it's not Wyvern, unless specifically Demist is lurking in Mist Cave with the Magri. And we know it's not the Lunars, because we saw that in Antlion. But it could be an extremely rude
opening. That is true, that would be very painful, especially after we've gotten all these rude bosses out of the way. Well, roll somebody into the faucet, then hit him with the sudden milk run.
And just to say nothing of the King Queen Eblin spot in front of it, there are a couple of rude possibilities in there. People Wall, DKC. Oh, a curse ring in the inventory. That's cute. We're going to take 15 off of edges. Sure, that will solve all of our problems.
Yeah. That'll... Yeah.
There are a couple of new situations where you can take advantage of some of the curse rings that are more interesting properties. If you're wearing something that protects you from an element and you also have a curse ring on, then you start absorbing that element. But we're also making sure to eat all the veggies, make all the checks before pursuing that book. And you know, you don't mind having a tower key when you get on.
Yeah, nobody... Well, I shouldn't say nobody. I'm sure there's at least one person who likes me to get this
power. I definitely didn't mind it on the flag set for the first half of the tournament, K Travel Chain, because that's a lot of key entries. But it is definitely less appealing under the circumstances.
That's weird. I do like trying to do it for whatever reason, just to be funny, but it seems every single time I try, they throw the power key at me as I try to do it.
It is a gamble running it keyless. You don't want to have to turn around and walk halfway up again if you find the tower key later, but, you know, that is also why tower key is one of my favorite vanilla results. Because if it's sitting there at the top of the tower, then you're putting it off all that time for nothing.
That is true.
And you're right, it is an oracle. It's not my absolute favorite vanilla. My favorite vanilla is a vanilla pan, as I am a big fan of the old Free Enterprise adage, check your freebies, do your objectives. So I like to get back to Shiva 1 as soon as I can.
I'm a big fan of a vanilla pan because I'm one of the people that likes to try to fade Bubble as long as possible. try to avoid multi-dipping in there, and it usually ends up biting me in the butt.
Yeah, there are definitely a few different schools of thought with looting, and the order in which your key item checks. A freebie that's been available for a long time, there's no risk. You just go ahead and make the check, and you're guaranteed that it's going to work out. No rude surprises. But going into places multiple times is time-wasting, so places multiple checks, like the pool, Sylph Cave, if you want to wait for man to go down there. We already talked about the Power Key. And then there's also the deal with Paddle Time. You might be more inclined to make a check if you happen to find yourself in the neighborhood. So, it's not cut and dried at all, which is one of the great things about the world.
Yeah, that's so true. It's all these little things you have to try to keep track of. It can all either add up or take away from your time, really.
Popper is taken on Evla Castle, probably for both loot and XP, before diving the hook route. You see that often.
Yeah, do not blame them at all. Simply found the format of the chest in the tower. Don't please check any other chests. Might just be trying to get a little slingshot on that radio, get her up to Leviathan level.
That would make a lot of sense, and I think you're right. Popfer pulled an Excal out of the three metal chest, and even if we can't find a Cecil, it's a very good one.
One of the few reasons you like to see an Excal, you gotta have a Cecil to swing it or an edge to throw it. Or I guess three if you really strap the cash and just want to sell it.
All of the spells off of that sneak shot, most of which will probably not be cast at all. Protect Ring is decent. It's not quite a crystal ring, but it's hard to argue with the boost it does provide to your defense and the element resistance.
Yeah, and we've been talking a lot about the mage defenses, but for everything else that isn't a mage, Tickering will do a nice job of keeping you covered from that.
So true. Parties are a little different. Slippery has opted to hold on to our intrepid mark. We'll see if that pays off. So, mages.
Yep, as soon as I said it, I knew something was going to come up. Now the
but you should have targeted Edge.
Again, like, another great thing about the randomizer is the flag sets that you can come up with, and really changed the experience, and the admins did a good job with this tournament, coming up with two great flag sets. We had Be No Free on in the first half, which meant that a lot of the tricks that one would use from these guards were not in play, and slinging their spells. And because of that, it became more apparent to a lot of us that the Zeus Gauntlet protects against size.
Did not actually know that one. That's a nice little piece of info for me.
We're gonna come back and heal, says, let's not do that again.
We still have the unknown boss to deal with, so safety save is definitely warranted.
Yeah. Plague. Yeah, annoying with the fast anchor, but manageable here, I think. We've already talked about Reddit and Pogo. Pale Dim, kind of in the middle of this. Oh dear. Throw the kitchen sink, Slippery, hold nothing back.
arm the catapults.
It just starts straight out with big wave, good for 50% of max XP. The magic, I don't think I've ever seen anyone dodge a wave here the way you can in some of the lower spots. And it's just gonna keep coming as you try and churn through 25,000 plus hit points without the benefit of any sort of real level grind beforehand.
Yeah, I think taking some of the crap chests in Evelyn would have definitely helped out a bit. I don't mind leaving Lydia down for this, because, like you said, she does not have a lot of spells that could be very useful. The only thing that she would cast is a summon, which, with Ogopogo being here, is not the best part.
Exactly. Why would that be bad?
Well, see, unfortunately, Ogopogo does not like it when you throw a summon at him, and he will counter with a pretty nasty one. Is it Blaze they counter with?
Yes.
Yeah, that one. And that is just more unnecessary damage your whole party would be taking instead of just one person getting sent.
Right. Edge would not be impressed by the points for at least on Slipper's side, because Slippery is the one that ran the pitchfork for the Adamantium, right?
Correct.
Right. And Blaze is an ice-based attack. Not fire, but an ice-based. Your only clue is that the flames are blue. But adamant armor protects from ice just as well as fire. So he wouldn't care. But it's still going to be a root for everyone else.
Ooh. Slippery threw that Ogopogo. Barely hanging on with an edge, 156 HP. Well done.
Yeah, very well done. Getting through a hook route Ogopogo on the first pass. Out in chat, if you are not already following Slippery and Klopfer, get on that. They're putting on a heck of a show, knocking out a lot of these fights that could have tripped up a lot of runners and forced a little bit of a stumbling block, and they're just taking them in stride and marching on through. And it's a pretty awesome comm scene as well. We've got Cub Rule on the restream, Scala, and not for normal role, lighting up the buttons for us. And I'm having a good time here with Wreckit, so swing on by if you got a chance. You'd see a lot more good stuff.
Definitely having a great time here too, if you commander.
Thank you. Klopfer not far behind, but it looks like Klopfer's gonna go straight in. I'm seeing some equipment, lots happening right now. A little bit of work to make Porum a better healer so that Rosa can focus on going pew-pew.
And Klopfer did do a little bit more grinding, not a whole lot. So I get the confidence is warranted, but the seeing this Ogopogo, it's never a good thing to see.
Yeah. And chat letting us know we've got some sort of Mylon at top of tower. No clue which one. Dancing Blue Robe here has to be Water Hag at Dwarf 1 because we already saw the gauntlet. And our run through Zot lets us know that it's going to be Water Hag into elements. So, yeah, not a bad tower, not a bad dwarf castle.
No, not bad at all. Water Hag's back, the three boss flags are in place, so all you gotta do is give them three little boops and he will go away.
Kafka, fight, Kafka. Fight? Fight? Do I look like a fighter?
Yeah, I don't think Kafka's really the type of person you want to tell to fight. I feel like last time he got into a fight, nothing good happened.
You're not wrong.
You're not wrong.
for taking a pretty straight up, pretty safe approach, which makes sense, especially given the lack of the save. Just let Edge keep swinging away and have both white mages focus on keeping everyone above 50% for as long as possible.
Yep, that is probably the best way to handle this. That is, there's the food you're talking about, right?
It's a dreamsicle food in that orange robe.
Orange dreamsicle. Dang it.
Dreamsicle. And just like that, elements are gone. Plotford lost one of his healers, but this has been going on long enough that I think he might get through. It's going to be close, though.
He did lose a healer, but got ready. So at least he still has two people going on healing.
Keep expecting each swing of those katanas to be the last. My breath. Gotta keep an eye on this war check. I know someone's been in Kaipo, but I don't remember who's there.
I do not remember either, and oh, that's a very nice shiny rock.
Yeah,
I was pretty much finished.
Yeah, as Ogopogo crumbles on Clockfur's side, Slippery, employing the Warp Glitch to come up with a Vanilla Dark.
That's true, that is a good little spell. I just forget about that. Try to forget about CLK as much as possible.
You know, that's fair. I can respect that choice.
Hourglass is for sale here in the Dwarf Castle. Running out of shops to find a siren.
Yeah, just Amra, Faymarch, and the moon. Could be one of those sirenless seeds, though. If it is, Edge can go after any of the eyeballs and steal sirens from them.
It is never truly a sirenless seed, as long as you've got a ninja wearing the hooded hood.
Well said.
Well, not like it matters. Plotford just informed us it is not in fact a sirenless.
Yeah, don't worry about it. Everything's.
Plan B is not needed at this time.
So Slippery's about a long check ahead of Plotford. But we do have room for divergence. So is definitely still anybody's game.
That is true. That is a big check, though, for Slipper getting that darkness crystal.
Absolutely.
Plopper making the only check that really matters. Job Dwarf Intel.
Yes, indeed. Seems like in this world full of magma and fire enemies, a fire prevention engineer would be a very respectable profession.
Yeah, I do not think he is hurting for payday around here.
Slippery also proving both of our runners are men of the people. Not to be confused with men of the steep. It's a completely different shtick. But also checking up on our job.
This is now a 100% validated run.
Huzzah. Scala gets it. The Unicat will definitely get it too if they were here.
Simply dipping his toes into the Fame Arch, found that warrior's chest pretty early on, so knows the rest of the cave is pre-looted.
Yeah, good chance of hitting 4 and 5 in here, so see how much he feels like taking advantage of that. Arm rod? Nice. Yeah, we're just gonna make sure we get that. It's the best we're gonna be able to do for you in these unprepped chests. Plus 10 to wisdom, which governs black magic, which really is what we bring Fool along for. We'll need to break into tier 6 to find the Stardust rod with the stat sticker. The inventory boss comes again. It waits for us all. And we do get a package out of it. We are one key item closer to 10. Is there a character that you would sit through the package cutscene in the Kaipo in fight, given the party that Slippery has right now?
Personally, not really. Even if we saw like a Cecil, don't even think I'd sit through for that. Unless I already had a crystal sword sitting around, then I'd probably consider it. With what Slippery's working with right now, I don't think we're going to bother checking.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised either to see it faded till the end of time. It'd be difficult for it to be truly punishing. The only way it's like it may... Even if there is a useful key item there, it might not save you time, depending on where your alternative is. And for it to be hard required would be really... And you know what? We can forget about all of that speculation. Demas is down here in the Fame Arch.
Yeah, I was about to say, maybe if I was really hoping to find a Demas with that pink tail behind him in the package route, but nope. He's chilling out with his Queen Vovalis by his side here in the Fame Arch.
Yeah, Scala was the package.
Yeah, that is not a Fame Arch I plan on doing anytime soon.
It can just sit right there, and if that happens to be hard required, I'll get back to it eventually, I guess. I tend not to forfeit, so yeah, we'll get back to it eventually.
Won't be happy about it. We'll get to it.
No, definitely will not be happy about it. Rumbling all the way. Oh, probably, you know, I think you take the... I personally would take the Demas first. It's going to be rude because it's fast and punchy, but it's also going to give me some decent mist phase time to get Blink set up. And between Fu and the White Mage that's being kept, it's two Blink casters. And if I wait long enough, Edge will also go image and can take care of himself. I'd probably start there.
Yeah, definitely a solid plan. I would not be in any rush to go mess with Vovalis.
And, chat, Slippery's doing something that you'll see a fair amount of. When you get underground, knocking out a couple of sirens real quick, although with the amount he's got in one hand, maybe he is sticking around for longer. I'm just gonna take it all the way. The short grind with 6 key items, pretty common. Going all the way would be a bit more.
I wouldn't be surprised if Slippery does just a few more and calls it good. Maybe just trying to get enough to fry that D-list.
Just a little jump start. Get some of, especially some of your characters that either joined late or didn't make it through some of the more XP-rich fights. Get them online into at least a mid-game. switching out airships. You don't want to spend too much time flying around the Falcon and accidentally land in front of Zod. But at least we've already done Zod.
Just making a quick drop off, move the hovercraft back where it needs to be.
Yeah, we've already got a hook, and Pinktail's an objective, and Rattail could lead to another key item. Oh, Moontella. Moontella.
That is a long bearded man to find on the moon.
Yeah. Tella plus Darkness Crystal usually equals D money. D-Money is a little trickier to pull off in this flag set because E-Cam Run is on, which means you have to set up your Manip in Baron or somewhere else on the overworld where you can take down the fights. But it's doable. It was developed by Twisted Flax and Simbu in response to the first tournament in which E-Cam Run became a featured flag. But it's a little more work, and we're over 50 minutes in, which is a little late on D-Money, and besides, Sirens are available in top. So, all of that together kind of pushes away from taking the top.
Plus, you know, the very obvious that we've already got food and it's like Super Tella.
Right, the elephant in the room, Foo. He's got 7 weeks on a full chamber instead of 4, and is less likely to miss the darn things if you don't feel like putting him in the center slot. Nice find out of the hairdryer. Sometimes you just take the hairdryer chest for experience, but this time there's a Masamune in there. Good times.
I'll never be upset to see that, but Slippery Dig Sheila 1 and was ordered with the Legends.
We love to see Sheila 1 pay off. Oh yeah. But Quapper not interested in early moon dive. Just wants to check the character, get the XP off the hair dryers, and then go back to Palin around Earth.
Yeah, not a bad play, all things considered. Hairdryer's nice chunk of experience. Make up for... Don't believe Clop was but for cracking ends, but that's it. I've already forgotten.
Don't think Clopper's gone down so set up. Might be hoping to hold out for it.
Instead, it's gonna start heading up that tower through the 2 checks we got here. We'll find out which version of Mylon is hanging out at the top.
And there's a few ways to approach the tower. Looks, we'll see how Clockford does it. You've got 2 save points and 2 checks, and there can sometimes be some thoughts about saving places if you plan on a reset, though the pot first seems to be going for a just straight up aggressive approach, which with a Mylon at top is justified. You're not really worried that something terrible is going to happen to you in this fight.
With a full power to edge swinging around, Les is already helping out too. Yeah, that's I do not blame the aggression.
Come on down, come to Lower Babel where the fun never ends. Come on now, come on, it's time for Mylon and Friends. Mylon and Friends!
I love it.
The the saddest lit one counters in the history of lit one counters. And now let's just talk about the drains, which are occasionally just going to miss.
And here comes Leviathan, just sweep the party away.
Sweep, 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 Leviathan. Sweep it all the night. Work, work, work behind it, sweeping all the night. Which is how we're going to get rid of Milo. Keep that.
Yeah, definitely will never be upset about it. Very interesting divergence. Yeah. Slippery kick in the moon. We're gonna poke that ribbon room, see if it's a little freebie we can get.
Yeah, it is an objective. It could very well have key items behind it that are also objective related, in which case, acquire. Check your objective. Do your objectives. Check things. Regardless. I have to come up with some quirks in the new of objectives one of these days.
So, don't believe we've seen the King Queen Eidolon fights. It could be here. That would be a nice, quick, and easy. Nope, it's a bunch of dolls.
Dolls are fine here, actually. An hour lasted to save it, and if it was Palom casting Quake, I'd be more confident in the possibility of it taking out all of the dolls even in this spot. But since it's Fu, I think that hourglass is obliged to crush it. Also, Frejectors. It rolls off the nut. Might have to go with that.
I like it.
Slipper just going with AoE damage anyway.
Interesting that I didn't see the Leviathan from it. You know he got it from the treasury. I don't know if he actually taught it to the deal.
Might be, could be a MP situation if Slipper is low on camping gear. Might not want to burn it here on a fight that's essentially solved with that hourglass. Ooh, hey, would you like another Adam Prom? I thought you would.
You know, now that you mention it, I could go for another Adam Armor.
Bob first getting a Luka Key coming out of Tower, which, given that we've seen every boss that could be progression and we've done the Warp Glitch, is just one more notch towards 10. So this is going to be our divergence. The Darkness Crystal forces this on choice on runners, especially, you know, when K-Moon is on. Do you go to the moon, make that your grind and your play for progression, or do you stick to Earth and hope that the answer is there?
It's always an interesting choice. I'm sure many, many runners have felt anytime they're faced with this, have I made the right choice? Have I made the wrong choice? Did my opponent pick correctly? It just, moments like these, I feel like they just start to eat at you after a while, too.
They do. You can really get inside your head with it. You make a decision and you have to commit to it. You can't just go back and forth and back and forth with it. But if you do go for it and you don't find much value, then just the thought of, if my opponent didn't come here, I'm in so much trouble. It really does weigh.
Slipper getting through that evil wall? Not much of a problem for what I saw. Only Excalibur will do damage. Like we said, nice to toss. We haven't seen a Cecil to use it, so
Yeah, not exciting. It's not what you came up here for. You came up here hoping to find, you know, the more objectives, the better. You did not come up here to clear the moon just to do a ribbon objective.
We are currently in the hunt for four of the items. Only three of them will finish off this seed. And having three of your checks already turn up with nothing, that can't be feeling good.
No, definitely not. Gotta keep at it and hope it works out. Plotfer making a bit of a bold play here, going after this vow. Like, again, if this vow has value, then Plotfer is going to feel great if he gets through this. He's got to figure there's a very good chance that Slippery did exactly what he did do, and just say, you know what? No, I can't. He's doing a good job getting those blinks up.
And I don't believe Plotfer has any admin armors compared to Slippery's 2s. This is extra impressive comparatively.
It's a plague down here at Masamune Altar. And Slippery did get somebody revived in time. Would almost be beneficial if the count just ran out on a couple of people before he got refreshed, and then he could just do a palm revive each time.
Okay, there you go. He had two more drop right before it went out.
Oh, there we go. Sometimes it works out. And there, you got your revive, and play has a new target to refresh, and you've got enough firepower in here that you should be able to get through without needing to flip anyone down.
Yep, there he goes.
Another fight very well handled by Slippery. Both of our runners putting on a show. You do love to see it.
Oh. There's some potential progression there, paying off for Slippery.
We might see the fable, no, give me the tail back. Turn in the rat tail, you get the pink tail as your reward, and the collector just realizes, wait, no, that was an extremely valuable tail for my collection. What was I thinking?
We do love to see that. It was just very much a, wait a minute here.
Slippery with the standard warp. Anyone that's done a long moon grind from bottom to top is pretty familiar with. Murasame is not what Plotfer wanted to see there, but you know, you make your play and it is what it is. I figure at this point Plotfer is going to stick around to finish the job at Fate March.
Yep, popping that cavern, and gonna head right back down, take on that demons. At least with Demas, you get two potential checks out of it. You get the check for the spot it's in, and then you can go see if Pretty is got any
bonus. Yep, our good old bonus round. Octomam in this spot that, like the Leviathan spot that Plotfer is going to go after, has amazing physical attack power that gets completely unused in the vanilla game.
Yeah, that's not gonna be fun. Having the admins is definitely making it easy. Yeah, Fu and Rosa, probably mostly just Rosa, going great. One of those bosses, initially you're like, oh no, and then you take a moment to think, like, oh, okay, I'm actually prepared.
Yeah, both of our runners will be able to handle these fights for different, you know, slightly different reasons. This spot just doesn't have enough HP to stand up to Slippery's assault. There we go. And Demas is going to give that time to set up links, and the only thing the Demas knows how to do is punch.
Ooh, there's the other half of the four for Slippery.
This is the value that Slippery wanted from this moon dive. Exactly what Slippery needed to see. All this leaves for a full clear is Murasame Altar and K value. Let's see if Slippery sticks around or bails.
So he's taking the bail. I understand, you know, good. Your objective.
Yeah, I could see it either way, honestly. You've got a rat tail to turn it. That could be something. Slippery, I don't believe, has run the tower. Correct me if I'm wrong on that. Has not. I see no. Yeah. So Slippery, from their perspective, has faded Fame Arch and a full tower and has some value. So it certainly makes sense. Paul Grant's making a prediction in chat on Rat Tail Apart, and
it is.
But it is the fabled rat to pink. Yes. Oh, I love it.
Hit him with the switcheroony.
Beautiful. So, yeah. How that? That's a fourth objective with a fifth on the docket. Slippery is one key item away from go mode. Just looking for a twin harp or a pan.
Yep, and I would not be surprised if Slippery just decides, hey, I'm right here, might as well go through the Fey March. Hopefully that Demas does turn into one of us. Either through here or through the mist check.
Yeah. Wouldn't be shocked though if Slippery goes for the tower first. It's gonna be easier checks than Fame Arch is gonna be. So we'll just have to see how that plays out. Ooh, Sasuke. That's good. That's a good find.
Ooh, even better those Stardust rods for Sam.
Or you just get one for free from fighting Demas. The free Astros. Might not have cost any money, but that doesn't mean it was free. Ow. Ow.
There are always other ways to play.
Yeah. GP or your HP. If this isn't an answer, then we're looking at the top of the mill to get this job finished, aren't
we? It is an answer, though.
Yeah. Okay. So that will be objective number 5 set up for Klopfer. That gives us enough knowledge here in the booth for a way out of the seed, although harp? Who knows? Could be part of those pan checks? Could be from the top of the moon. I guess we'll find out soon.
I'm hoping harp is a Shiva too. I hope we get to hear a little bit of music tonight.
We do love to hear the music. So many songs in the harp pool. Started out with Palm Lamity as a original and our harp dev, and then after a while Xenocat took over and they really started working on expanding the library. If you ever wondered why there are so many Xenogear songs in the harp pool, that would be why. Oh, and Scala letting me know that Ward also did a lot of the early songs. Thank you. Appreciate that. Crystal something. I didn't catch that.
Crystal Ring.
Oh my, it's the best crystal other than the sword.
Yeah, definitely not a bad piece of gear to see.
Man, one of my favorite pieces of equipment. +5 to agility, some amazing physical and magical boosts, and also resists dragons and paralyze. some other thing that almost escapes me. Light, maybe.
I feel like it's light.
Bottom instrument is lightning.
Lightning's just a really big element. A lot of things are weak to it, a lot of things resist it. It's a big deal.
Well, Fantasy IV, Lightning Strikes Back.
It's a pass from Pan 2, but hey, that's not the worst thing in the world if you end up finishing up your objectives on the Earth.
Yeah, that flight up and walk down takes longer than you think. And especially if you're worried about your Z fight, if you don't get through it on the first time, saving yourself a walk down, a second walk down from the river.
Always, the trip up to the moon always feels longer than going there to fight instead of just going up there to ship.
I completely forgot we had an unchecked bearing key amongst our options, so that could be what gives us the remaining outs in terms of the part.
That's true. The part could be either from the Eden Chronum or could be down in the Baron Basement.
But there are at least three objectives that you've got to go to the moon for, so Clopfer's gonna have to make their way up there sooner or later. They've got the rat tail from the moon that gave us the pink tail, the obvious ribbon room there, and half a forge was up at the crystal sword altar. So, yeah, gotta get up there sooner or later. Problem being, of course, that Clopfer doesn't know this. And from what he knows, this is a perfectly reasonable play. You want to commit to clearing out Earth and hope that it added your value, but yeah, that sometimes is the way to go.
Yeah, like we said, that trip to and from the moon can eat up some time, especially if you gotta make multiple trips. It does make sense to just stay down. That's right, I forgot it was karate that made us way back in over an hour.
Yeah, I did. That's true. So now what will you do, Slipper? You've got some options. Say March. Alright, instead, you're gonna follow in the Baron Castle. Chuck Ultra, Forced Magma was a flag in the first half, the first 4 weeks of the tournament. That flag isn't on. We haven't seen a Magma Key. Both of our runners took the hook route, which was the logical path underground in this series. Yeah, exactly. Two flag sets this tournament, which, again, impressive job by the admins getting two different flag sets ready that are very different from each other and both still letting us put on a good show as runners.
Yeah, I have been thoroughly enjoying both of these flag sets. Potion Party grew on me. It was weird at first, but I kind of miss it now.
And as a diehard member of Shoppers Anonymous, it was did not play to my strengths, but it definitely had its charm. I would be lying if I said I didn't enjoy.
Clopper making an interesting play, switching out the Rydia for a fresh cane. Interesting.
He's got a white spear. And if he doesn't want to go reflect strats, then, oh, hey, look at that. Hopper doesn't know it, but that's bad news for him. Slippery right on his heels. But if if you don't want to go heavy reflex strats and you don't think you're going to take the time to get Rydia to nuke, then, you know, I can see it. She needs a lot of XP to level.
That is true. Sure, both runners haven't thrown that way to do yet.
It's definitely a could go emo check, and has probably as much to do with runner preference as it does with anything else. Also, Clopper might not have had the power of Glarm. It makes a difference.
That is very, very true. Glarg is a fantastic reason to hold on to that idea.
So, Carrington a little bit wants Dark Elf. Deals with these pesky invaders ruining his sleep. We're going to be treated to a randomly selected song. How appropriate was it? I didn't even notice this. But it was Edward playing the harp that saved us in there before we got.
I did not even catch that. Glad you pointed it out. I think we're going to take a moment of silence while DJ Spoon B takes it away and gives us some nice music.
Nice, we listened to it twice. Yeah, another wonderful harp composition with music from the Seventh Saga. Dragon God wins for speed. Cubs rule. Although Swag Rocks certainly has style points.
You can never forget about the style points.
Indeed. Now, Slippery doesn't have the pass from running the pan checks, so it's gonna have to head up to the moon and walk down. But Hopper needs to find what he needs for two key item checks. He's gonna go straight to the Riven Room, of course. After that, well, Rat Tail is progression down at Masamune, but bail for it, questionable. So the real play that gets him out of here is to find the Adamant at the first Sword Altar. I think Slippery needs to wipe at least once to his rocks. Though, there's still a grind incoming, so we'll see.
Yeah, I think that's all we can really hope for is either a wipe or two to help close in the gap.
Yeah, you never want to count Z out. Z is, when you get a Z fight down just right and all flowed your way, it's a thing of beauty. And if those are the only Z fights you've seen, you might wonder what the big deal is. But if you've ever seen one go sideways or watched someone scrape through with just enough power, then you already understand.
Zoramis does not care how prepared you think you are. He is there to quickly remind you he's probably more prepared.
Yeah, and Paul Grant's making a good point in that Ed Sheeran will make it a lot more interesting. If you know what you're about, then you know to try and leave Edge at 28 or 42 agility, or even 56 if things are spacey, because you get the most bang for your buck in terms of slowing down Zoramis without slowing your own party down any more than absolutely necessary. But for a lot of runners that are more accustomed to a perfectly anchored Z fight, Edge definitely makes you go ahead and move.
100%. Saw that there. Poke into the Riven Room, saw the dolls, decided, you know what? I need to get a little more XP on my belt. Don't hate it. It's a smart play.
Yeah, I'll have to remember to ask if Klopfer comes in for an interview, but it feels to me like Klopfer thought about the fact that you get a lot less XP from that fight with the dolls and decided to go ahead and get the XP now. Double life glitch by Klopfer on these dragons. That's worth more than a Riven Room fight. Nicely done.
Yeah, you'd love to see it happen. Especially that game is just straight up. 36 levels, I think it was, in one fight.
Yeah, and that explains keeping Kane down during the Twin Heart fight. Wanted to get the slingshot. And so, yeah, walking away from the Riven Room there now does make all sorts of sense. That's not much of a slingshot off of the dolls of Riven. Heads up. Very nice. Why was that life glitch so helpful?
Well, you see, there's a little silly bit of a code in with the enemies. The way the life spell or life potion works, it revives whoever you use it on. They come back with a number of HP equal to 5 times their vitality, and you can use it on enemies, as we saw. Funny thing is, though, enemies have a vitality of 0. And just quick question, 5 times 0 is what?
It's on Final Jeopardy last night. I'm gonna go with zero.
That would be correct. So the enemies get brought back to life with zero life, and you don't see it happen, but they do just immediately pass away again, giving you full experience for basically killing them twice.
And it doesn't work on bosses, right?
No, unless they're one of the freebie bosses. I think it still works on them.
Yeah, if they don't have the boss bits like the Baron Guard we spoke of, you're right, life lift will work then. Though there are a few enemies in LST Trap Chest that have the audacity to have a boss bit nonetheless. Looking at you, Blue and Red Dragon and Behemoth, you know what you did.
Not bad enough that they're already annoying to deal with normally, but can't even hourglass them or anything.
Nope. None of that.
The audacity.
Concuss Gamer, did you know that in a right triangle, the square of the sums of the two shorter sides is equal to the square of the sum of the hypotenuse?
I think I remembered it. He's one of those.
I only have a brain. How we're going about what you'd expect after a rip heading straight over to White Sphere. Slippery, meanwhile, has finished round, has made the save in the Ribbon Room, and is walking for one last trip through the crystal pillars of the lunar subterranean. And that means that Skella Kitty is starting the parade of people waving certain flags. Why is that happening?
Well, so we're going down to the main objective. We gotta finish off Zoramas, the big bad of the game. And everything else in this is great. So now we put bosses in places they're not supposed to be. Zoramas, not so much. He's a little too beefy, a little too scary to put in other places. But we didn't want him to feel left out of the randomness. So we have random sprites every time you battle him. We have a giant collection. Not sure how many we have at this point. Too many puppets, probably. So, the question we're going to be asking very shortly is, whose butt are we about to kick?
Exactly.
Now we're playing at, we have 600 plus, so apparently we can kick.
Then put in by Scotland. Yeah, and I know Boardfits did some of that earlier. Hi, Perkiomus? Words are.
Yeah, I'm just gonna go with that because I don't even have a guess.
Chat letting us know bonus boss from Final Fantasy II on PlayStation 4.
I think it's one of my it's the one version of Final Fantasy II I never played.
That will do it, man. Counter to go. Oh my! 2284 on the counter. That's a lot.
It is. I don't think Rosa has one of the readjustments that Slippery has.
Being said, that's very beefy, gang. I suspect Slippery will be just fine. We shall see.
I would, in fact, call that a diva puppy. I would not recommend petting a diva puppy. Something tells me that is bad.
Agreed. Do not pet the demon puppy. Oh. That's the funny thing, though. We talked about the difficulty of the edge. But this meant that its slowing Zeromus down enough that there was enough time to work around to Yang and toss a pure potion to deal with that. A lot of times with the more traditional Z fight, you don't have time to pull that off unless you have a character waiting to perform the heal with the correct response.
Yeah, normally you need to foresee like three different timelines into the future to be able to predict just who's going to get hit, heal up that cure potion, and just hope the stars align. But now with this, we can actually be kind of reactive. More reactive instead of being put.
Buffer making a save, and he's gonna save Scum for his rat tail check. That's gonna be exactly the right decision. But you know what? Slippery is done with just some reflect strats, taking down Zeromus in short order. GG's.
GG indeed. I look away for 1 second. Oh. Very well done.
Yeah. Extremely. We'll see if Slippery joins us in for an interview afterwards. But in the meantime, Clopper's not going to be far behind. Already landing the hovercraft and about to get the crystal. And yes, we are indeed joined by Slippery. GG.
Boy, thank you very much.
That Z fight was very well handled. How'd you feel going into it?
Oh, pretty good. I mean, I think Ridia was a little bit underleveled based on what I would have liked, but you know, with adamant armor on, that doesn't really matter so much. So, and I'm used to doing Z with three spellcasters, since I think that was kind of the predominant meta from a previous tournament. So, yeah, it worked out well.
Worked out very well, I would say. Yeah, that was just a very clean run, as I was saying. I looked away for 1 second, turned back, and Z was flashing.
Oh yeah, adamant armor is so delightfully overpowered. So and having three of them that run was very fun.
Yeah, you were definitely not lacking for power in that department.
So, I want to talk routing a little bit. I don't know if you've had a chance to talk to Klopfer, but the main difference is the eternal question of the Darkness Crystal. You charged after that moon pretty early, and it paid off pretty big in a lot of objectives. Is that something you normally do, or was there something specific to this siege that made you feel like it was the play?
Well, the specific thing for the seed was really my party's equipment. I had, like, Bahamut Ridia, I had Adamant on Edge, who could basically berserk through basically anything. I think Fu was in my party, so he could nuke stuff down. So I figured, like, even though I'm a bit underleveled, you know, I'll scramble a few eggs to get myself, you know, a little bit safer, but I don't need to do too much preparation, and I should be able to handle any challenge on the moon. Plus, I had already seen a lot of the nastier bosses, like they were already accounted for, like Demis, which is really slow in those late game spots. Saw Ogopogo, saw Golbez. So, yeah, I was figuring, okay, so there might be like moderate threats on the moon, but nothing the party can't handle.
I think even with the power you had, you wouldn't have been too impressed by a TKC. You went back to Earth to chase your rat tail and the other things on Earth, which proved to be the right play, but were you at all tempted by the Murasame Altar or K-Value?
I was. I usually like to be pretty thorough when I go to the moon, but I also figured I'm just down to key item hunts, and I can, you know, cash cash one in for something else. I can cash in my forge as well, which will make the remaining fights a little faster and probably make up the difference in transit time if I needed to go back to the moon to pick up those last two spots. So I figured, you know, what the heck, I'll roll the dice, and this time it actually worked out in my favor.
That it did.
Always good when your gambles pay out.
Oh yeah, I had during last week's Seed of the Week, which was this flag set, you know, I played it just absolutely horribly, so I was looking for some revenge on it.
Well, I would definitely say that you had gotten your revenge. Definitely a redeemer run right there.
Oh yeah.
So, let us know, where does this put the match between your two teams?
You know, I haven't checked the standings yet this week. I've had a fairly busy week so far, but well, hopefully I put us one step closer to getting us through the round.
You definitely did, no doubt. Any last questions? Any last thoughts from the two of you here?
No, I think we covered just about everything we wanted to know. GG's once again, Dia Slippery.
Thank you very much, and cheers to all of you in the broadcast booth making this thing possible.
Well, thank you for putting on the show. Without it, there wouldn't be anything to talk about.
Right on.
And I had a chance to check on the website while that was getting wrapped up. Right now, between Big Trouble and Little Typo and Golbez, there are no matches reported, so from where we're sitting, this puts Scurry's team up 1-0. For those of you unfamiliar, three players from each team will play each week, and whichever team gets two of the wins secures the win for their team. So this isn't over for our new legal squad of Gobeza.
Nope, but it does take a little pressure off of at least one of Slippery's teammates. Only one of them needs to take their match in order for them to take the point.
And currently, Big Trouble and Little Kaipo 3-2, Golbez 2-3, both still very much alive. As we have a crumbling Aromas here over on Clopper's side, coming in at 140-56, GG.
Hey, thank you, GG's, and GG's the Slippery, well run by him.
Oh, and there you are, hey.
Surprise.
Nicely done.
thank you very much.
Yeah, it was definitely a seed that had a few fights that could have tripped up a lot of runners and have tripped up a lot of runners in the past, and both you and your opponent took each hurdle in stride and put on a great show.
Excellent. I definitely am excited to watch this one back, because yeah, I agree, there was definitely some fights that we ran into there that were tough and I was concerned about dropping, and you could very easily like set me back far in the run. So it'll be exciting to see how both of us get through those and see where our times match up there.
Yeah, that was just well run by both of you. That hook route was
not that bad. Kindest. Yeah, definitely. There was a little concern there seeing the sparkle while I was scouting around picking up characters and finding the items we could buy and loot that was available. Keeping track of who we already saw, Ogo was definitely there at the front of my mind, so went ahead into Evelyn Castle to pick up a little more power. But we'd found enough by that point that once we got to it, I was pretty confident we could take on that fight. Edge was hitting really hard, Bacchus him up, and just everyone else on healing duty with whatever means we have. So cure two pots and white mages doing what they could.
Yeah, you're gonna hear a little bit of the raised eyebrow if you go back and watch the commentary from me when you go into that without the save, especially since we had already seen the boss on the other side. Slippery was underground just a tad before you, but I gotta respect that you knew you could handle it, even if it was the dreaded Ogopogo, and you proved yourself right.
Yeah, pretty sure I had the right step tools. You probably did notice I went ahead and menued before entering the fight, as I did realize yes. I had to get every edge I could there before taking on that fight, so got in and got all my healing just up as high as I could, and then went in that fight really hoping to see Plague instead, but we did not. So, alright, it's fine, let's just go ahead, get everyone on healing duty, we'll get our edge served up, and we get through this, which we were able to do. There was definitely some nice targeting there. If Pormund got knocked down a little earlier in that fight, things might have gone a little more out of hand. But did not, got through it, so I was happy with that.
Yep, and so you get on the ground to make your way to Dwarf Castle as you do, and find a vanilla darkness crystal, and as always happens when you get that darkness crystal and K-Moon is on, you have to ask yourself, do I go to the moon or do I stick to Earth? Do you normally like to stick to Earth, or was there something about this seed that made you hang around the blue planet?
I generally like sticking to Earth. The true key item checks, as opposed to the summon locations and moon locations, are a bit higher probability of actually containing the key items. So if I have good density still of those to do on the blue planet, I will. Especially because I was still missing so many key items at that point to be into go mode. Once I got down to maybe one left, I think I'd be much more likely about wanting to head to the moon at that point, especially with the ribbon room on the objective list. It just happens when I got to that point of just being one shy. I also had done a lot of character checks, had still not found that Cecil and had an Excal, so I was like, let's go ahead and do Baron Castle, because maybe he's hanging out in there. That kind of then sent me down through another set of checks to do on the blue planet. And as well as the, sticking to the blue planet, I generally stay away from the summons, but once you're in the Fae March, you might as well do all the summons that are there. And Demist, again, being kind of a pain to take on there, but just the fact it's two key item checks, the summon check and then the true key item check at Ridia's mom, shit, I couldn't pass it up. Again, knowing I had the tools necessary to take on the fight, it hits hard, but you get that Mist Phase to just go ahead and blink everyone up. You can get through the fight, so I went ahead and took it on.
Yeah, just very well handled. We actually had talked about that, about the mist. It gives you that little break. You get a nice little breathing room. It hurts, but it's not terrible.
Yeah, exactly. Like, you're generally concerned about punchy bosses in that spot, just for the very high attack power. But something that gives you a break like Demist, and especially with access to two blink casters, it's a fine fight.
Yeah, worked out very well.
Yep.
It definitely showed off your knowledge of the bosses. Adamantless for a long time with that adamant armor.
Yeah, I did go hunting for them in some high percent places to find Evelyn Castle. I even went ahead and checked the hairdryer chest pretty late in the seed, hoping for, some good armor there. But we finally did get our hands on some, so at least that made our Seruma Spice nice and easy.
Yeah, if you go back and watch the replay, you're gonna see that Slippery was hanging on to three adamant armors by the end.
Nice, I'll have to find out where those were.
There was the one straight from the ribbon room.
Mm-hmm.
There was one for turning in the pink tail.
Uh-huh.
And if you full clear a Zot, the witch, you'll see both of us commenting that, you know, I wouldn't have this adamant armor either. I wouldn't have gone on hunting for that flame dog after the first two chests, but
that's exactly my routing is, well, these two chests are on my way. They're really not too, don't take a lot of extra time to check and see if we get the flame dog. But yeah, those further out of the way chests, I generally don't like spending the time for that. And yeah, most of the time you don't miss that adamant armor, but hey, sometimes you do.
Right.
Runs.
Sorry.
I was just saying, just how it goes, rando will skin a rando.
It is. And you know, ain't nobody got time as a runner, as a commentator, or as in chat for 399 out of 399. Though I hear Escrunt is still lobbying to make Looters Anonymous a thing. But until that day happens, we're just going to have to choose which checks are worth our time and which aren't. And sometimes it's going to work out and sometimes no, as you said.
Yep, definitely. Still, there was enough power in the seed even without that adamant armor, so could have been a lot ruder than it was. So still thankful I found the tools necessary to get through everything.
Yeah, and that you did. So as far as I could tell from looking at the race bot stats, this is the first match of the week between your two teams?
It is. I do believe our second is actually just later tonight and coming on up, and then the other one over the weekend.
Nice. Well, looking forward to that, because just takes two out of the three. Mm-hmm. So there's very much still a chance for the Golbezza to emerge victorious.
For sure, all the Golbezzas have been training very hard, so I'm hoping to see some good races, and I'll definitely be tuning in and watching those. It should be a fun time.
Absolutely. That, you know, for me, that has been, and I'm sure for everyone in the tournament, having this team format set up as well as it has been, where, you know, everyone gets matched up against someone that they've got a fair chance against, and the teams themselves being pretty well balanced, and just the camaraderie between your teammates has made this, for me, a really wonderful experience, this team tournament. So, you know, hats off to the admins for figuring it out and making it happen.
Yeah, 100% agree. It's just been great having this like team atmosphere and just getting together in our chat rooms, and like we've been doing a bunch of team asyncs together and talking through those. It's just been an absolute great time. So definitely appreciate all the work admins put into putting these, you know, teams together in this tournament. I'm sure it's more complicated than all the other tournaments, which are already pretty challenging. But it definitely feels worth the work. It's been a lot of fun playing in this and watching. So big thanks, big shout out to the admins for putting this all together. It's been a great time.
100%. This has just been an absolute delight from every single side, commentating, playing and watching. It's just been just nonstop good times.
Yeah, well, that'll just do it for me. So, and the two of you have any last questions or any last thoughts there, Klopfer? Go for it.
Nothing too much other than, you know, just big thanks to the commentary restream team here for putting on this, and the admins, sorry, thanked. And find your Cecil, swinging those holy swords, always feels nice. So see what you can do on that front. Good luck to everyone in their own races and their own seats.
Well said, and I, for one, will definitely take that advice to heart.
Absolutely.
So that was Klopp for everyone. As we said earlier, Runners put on a great show. Give him a follow. You've heard it from Klopfer, and I'm sure it's also true from Slippery. They'll be getting a lot of practice in, so you'll be able to see a lot more of how the Moonvale Mixer flag set works in a lot of different scenarios. So go take a look. The commentary team here, the restream team, put on did a lot of good work too. Cub Rule with a nice roll and keeping everything cropped and up and running. Scala Kitty getting all the buttons lit up and cracking the action. And you know, Rekt had a great time Had a great time on comms with you. Absolutely.
It was my pleasure to be here with you, Commander, and it was one heck of a race to watch.
That it was. And we've got more Free Enterprise racing action for you. We are heading over to Free Enterprise 2 to join a race that is just about to start. Remember, everyone, do not spoil the results of this race. People like to go back and watch the VODs themselves and enjoy all of the thrills. So you can just say it was a great race and you should definitely watch it.